Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J traveled to Phoenix to participate in Alliance Defending Freedom's Blackstone Legal Fellowship, where she gave two talks. This is the second one, Defending Marriage, on why marriage matters and what has happened and will happen as it gets more and more redefined by the progress of the sexual revolution. If you missed the last talk, check out the previous podcast.
So in this talk, as I mentioned, we'll be covering the subject of the redefinition of marriage and whether society needs a gender requirement for marriage. We'll be discussing that. But the way I want to discuss it with you is I want to fit it into the larger picture of the march of the sexual revolution, okay? So those of you from Blackstone who've heard this lecture an incredible number of times, there's some different material in here now, so you guys won't want to get bored. So here's the presentation outline. I'm going to start by telling you what I think the sexual revolution is, give you my definition of it, my understanding of it, and then the bulk of the talk will be to explain how the current marriage issue fits within that march of the sexual revolution, including what will happen next. What's the next step? Right? It's not like we're going to have gay marriage in all 50 states and then nothing will happen. More things will happen, and we want to talk about what some of those things might be. And then finally, what are we going to do about it? What are we going to try to do about it? So before I do that, though, I have one point that I want to begin with to put into your hearts and into your minds, and that is I want you to understand that people of faith are on the right side of history. That's the first thing I want you to understand. Okay? So let's look over our shoulders. Let's look back. One thing that's great about being a Christian is that we have a nice long history we can look at. In the time of Jesus, men had the right to end their marriages unilaterally. Right? We know this from Matthew 19. If you didn't know anything about the ancient world, you could infer that from what Jesus says in Matthew 19 and parallel passages in Mark 10. Jesus put a stop to unilateral divorce, didn't he? I say to you, no divorce. One to a customer for life. That's a slight paraphrase. You know Catholics don't do Bible verses, but you know the passage I'm talking about. You got the basic idea. And of course it was radical when he said it. The apostles were completely freaked out, right? You can tell that from the context. They're completely blown away by that. This is too hard, Jesus. We can't handle it. And then he starts talking to them about celibacy, and then they really, there's no record of what they said after that. But anyway, so first off, Jesus put a stop to unilateral divorce. In ancient times, the pater familias, the father of the family, had life and death power over the members of the family. And in particular, the father of the family had the right to expose an infant. Father of the family had the right to say, we're going to leave that baby out on the hillside. I don't want that one. And he didn't have to have a reason. He could just say it. Well, guess what? The church put a stop to that. The church put a stop to that in the Roman Empire. And remember, the church was, you know, a bunch of nutcases running around in catacombs. And this is the Roman Empire we're talking about, right? But the church put a stop to that. How did they put a stop to it? Because women were attracted to the church. Because women knew if they married a Christian man, he wouldn't do that to them. They wouldn't have to do that if they married a Christian man. So the church put a stop to this kind of power of the father of the family. And then the final thing I want to point out is that throughout the Roman Empire, slavery was accepted. Slavery was a normal part of life in the ancient world, right? Aristotle famously said some people were born to be slaves, some people are natural slaves, some people are natural masters, so on and so forth. It's a completely accepted part of the life of the greater Mediterranean basin, which was the whole world at that time. That was understood. Slavery is part of it. But you know what? Christendom put a stop to that. Slavery was gone throughout Christendom. We don't think about this because we have this incredible weight of our American history of slavery. But on the eve of the Reformation, on the eve of the discovery of the Americas, there was no slavery anywhere in Western Europe. The area known as Christendom, there was no slavery. Slavery existed on the periphery. When you were in warfare with Islam, people would take prisoners of war and those people would be enslaved. And so people were used to slavery as prisoners of war. That's what people thought slavery was. But inside Christendom, there were peasants, there were serfs, but there was no slavery. There was no buying and selling of human beings within Christendom. It took a long time, but they got rid of it. Now, my point here is that all of these issues, divorce and remarriage, abortion and infanticide, slavery, the buying and selling of human beings, all of these things the Christian religion put a stop to. But they're all on their way back because of the sexual revolution. Sexual revolution is bringing back all of these points. And so that's what I want you to keep in mind, that we, in fact, are on the right side of history. We've been through this before. We've seen this movie. We kind of know how it ends. But the perennial human problem is that the strong prey on the weak. And if you think about those three issues we were talking about, that's what they all come down to, isn't it, right? I can grab you and sell you into slavery. I can get away with it, so I'm going to. You're a baby. I'm a grown-up. Get over it. You're going to die. That's all I have to say. You know, the strong preying on the weak, that is a perennial human problem. And Christianity has consistently said that that is wrong. We got to do something about that. And of course, that's a problem that always comes back. That's a problem that will never be finally solved, right? We have to understand that as Christians. You never finally solve the problem of sin, right? It's going to be with us all the time. But that's what we think is our job to do. And we actually kind of did it there for a while, right? And these things are coming back as a result of the sexual revolution. So I don't want you guys. I'm going to say something to, are there lawyers back there? All right, listen to me, you guys. I don't like religious liberty arguments. I'm going to tell you why. Because when we're talking about religious liberty, you know what it sounds like? It sounds like we're whining. You're not going to let me do what I want in my church. So what are you, a snake-handling religion? You know? I mean, we have to defend ourselves on the merits of our positions rather than hiding behind the First Amendment and saying all religions are allowed to do whatever they want. So please, please be nice to us. Don't pick on us. You let the peyote cult do what they want. You let the snake-handling religion do what they want. Please don't hit me. Please don't be mean to me. Forget it. Our position is the correct position. We need to be arguing for it on the merits and not simply hiding behind the First Amendment or hoping that the First Amendment is going to save us. Let me tell you something. You guys, you may not have noticed this, but our pagan culture couldn't give a rip about our religious liberty. Have you noticed that? They're not going to listen to that anyway. So I think it's time to go on the merits of the case itself. And yeah, okay, these are unpopular positions, but if nobody ever speaks up on them, they'll continue to be unpopular. Nobody will ever know a correct argument against them. All right, so let's talk about the sexual revolution and why I think it's such a disaster. Okay, I say the sexual revolution has two main points. Now, you guys have these slides, right? You guys all have these slides? Were these slides given to you? Okay, so you can look up here. You can take notes. I don't know, were you guys playing solitaire out there? What's going on? Anyway, it's always a problem when people have their laptops open. You just never know what's going on. Anyway, in my opinion, the sexual revolution consists of two main points. The first point is that society ought to separate sex and childbearing from each other, and we ought to separate both from marriage. So the first point of the sexual revolution is that we can separate sex and procreation from each other and separate both of them from marriage. Okay, if you think about it, if you let your mind run down the list of the things that are, you know, commonly understood to be part of the sexual revolution, you'll see a lot of them fit under that, right? You cover a lot of them under that point. Sex is a recreational activity, so on and so forth, okay? Second point of the sexual revolution is that men and women are completely interchangeable. Men and women are completely interchangeable. Any differences that you observe between men and women are morally suspect and certainly culturally conditioned. Okay? Is that a familiar concept to you guys? Okay. So the fact that the child development specialists study issue after issue after issue, when do you take your first step? When do you have your first, when do you have your first word? When do you go like this and cross the midline? All these different developmental tasks that children do, boys do them differently than girls. All of them. You separate out boys and girls. The developmental timetables are different. On average, now I'm talking averages again, but on average, boys and girls are different in every single developmental task you can think of, you know, for the most part. So, men and women actually are different. But we are ideologically committed to the position that they're not, and that all those differences are culturally conditioned. Now, the reason I have this slide up here is I want you to take a look at this slide. I got this from the Boston Globe, and this was a puff piece that the Boston Globe did on how cool it was going to be that children could soon have six parents. And so if you look at the the configurations there, this is a story about how cool it was that, you know, on one side you've got a biological parent who's got these relationships, and on the other side you've got a biological parent with the other relationships, so on and so forth. I'm not going to go into why the Boston Globe thought that was all cool. What I want to point out to you is that child. Look at the child in the center of this whole thing. That child is a generic child. You cannot tell whether that's a boy or a girl. So I just want to point out, I personally am a woman. Just for the record, I am in a woman. I am in a woman's body. All of you guys are in bodies, right? And the body, our species, we come in male and female. And we're like freaked out over this, right? The sexual revolution is against this biological fact. They consider it a cosmic injustice. Whereas Christianity says that male and female was designed by God for spiritual reasons, for natural reasons, and that it is all good, right? And so we have to be prepared to defend that in the natural order and in the supernatural order. But we have to recognize what we're dealing with. We're dealing with people who are freaked out over the human body. All right, wait, I think our next speaker will probably have something to say about that. So what I want to point out is that this ideology, the sexual revolution, in my opinion, is a totalitarian ideology. Because it is not possible to bring into being the two things that I just talked about. It's not possible to create a world where sex doesn't make babies. One time I had a conversation. This was actually a Federalist Society event. I was invited to a Federalist Society event. I was in a debate, and I made what I thought was a perfectly unexceptional statement. I said, sex makes babies. The lady argues with me. She says, no, it doesn't. I'm like, oh, really? Tell me about it. And she says, unprotected sex makes babies. Okay? So children are not the result of conjugal union of husband and wife or man and woman. Children are contraceptive failures. Okay? But the problem with this as an ideology to say that sex can be separated from childbearing is that these little contraceptive failures keep popping up. Right? You cannot completely suppress the natural differences between men and women or the connection between sex and babies, right? And so, therefore, it's impossible to achieve, and therefore, it requires a lot of force, and it requires a constant diet of propaganda to maintain it. Because you have to be continually reminded that men and women are really different. Men and women are really the same. That sex doesn't have to make babies. You have to be continually reminded of this precisely because the little babies keep popping up and differences between men and women keep asserting themselves. Right? If you're just a normal person going through a normal life, you're going to notice these things. So they have to be at you all the time with stuff that looks an awful lot like propaganda. So if you ever have the feeling that this is all like weighing on you, like it's relentless, like you're here, like you can't, like, can we get this out of our minds? Can we get this out of our heads? You are correct. It is relentless. And it needs to be. If you're going to commit yourself to doing something that's impossible and basically inhuman, that's what you're committing yourself to doing, is the relentless thing. And so finally, the final point is that the sexual revolution is a pagan ideology. It is a pagan ideology, and no Christian should have anything to do with it. You should not be compromising with it. We should not be compromising with it. And many of us did. Many of us have, right? Me, charter member of the Mary Magdalene Club, okay? I know this doesn't work. But the point is to face up to it, right? And deal with the fact that if that's that this is what it is. It's completely at odds with the Christian vision of the human body, the Christian vision of human sexuality, and indeed the Christian vision of the cosmos itself, right? So we have to confront that fact. Now, so that's my brief discussion of what the sexual revolution is. How does this current big issue of the definition of marriage fit in to the overall picture of the sexual revolution? So our current hot button issue, as I don't need to remind you, is the issue of whether we're going to have a gender requirement for marriage, whether we're going to have genderless marriage. So I think if you analyze that, and you guys, I know you hear about this all the time, you talk with your friends about it all the time, you hear what they have to say about it all the time, I'd like to kind of break down some of the presuppositions, you might say, that are behind the belief that genderless marriage is not only a good thing, but a moral requirement, okay? Because that's what we're dealing with, okay? What do you have to already believe in order to take for granted that genderless marriage is a good thing? I think there are at least three things that you have to already believe. The first thing you have to believe is that marriage is principally about adults and their feelings, and that it's not really very much about children and their needs. Okay? Marriage is principally about adults, what they want, how they feel. It's not really about delivering justice to children so the children have their legitimate entitlement with the mother and father, relationship with the mother and father, so that that is respected and protected in law within the society. Marriage doesn't have anything to do with that about kids. Marriage has to do with adults and how they feel. And society already believes this. This is why I'm putting this up there. Society pretty much already believes this. That's what unilateral divorce is all about. It's about saying mom and dad get to do what they want, and the kids will be fine as long as their parents are happy. Right? Have you ever heard that? The kids will be fine. Kids are resilient. Okay, that's a part of our cultural narrative that we have to have in order to believe that this is okay. So this culture has already absorbed this message. And many of the people that you're dealing with, they may not be able to say this. They may not have this top of mind. But this is in the background of what they're thinking. Secondly, we have to believe that sex is intrinsically or perhaps normatively a sterile activity. And babies are thrown in as an afterthought if you happen to have quirky lifestyle preferences. You know, it's okay to have a baby if you want a baby, if you really like that sort of thing. But basically, we're running the whole society on the premise that sex is a sterile recreational activity with no social or moral significance, right? Well, if you're going to have sex having no social or moral significance, in order for that to be true, you have to sterilize the act. Right? You have to remove the possibility of the baby being there, or you can't very well say it's a private act, because that third person is always a possible presence, right? So this is an essential feature of the sexual revolution. Without this concept that sex is normatively sterile, the whole rest of the structure would fall apart. You see what I mean? You have to have mentally sterilized the sexual act. And again, we know that lots of people believe this, right? Your career paths in a certain way are built on that. Because you're not going to have your first baby till you're 30 or whatever. Well, are we all going to live chaste lives until we're 30? Well, some of you are. I know some of you are, but you know that you're freaks, right? I mean, no offense. No offense, but I mean, you know, I don't have to explain this to you. You could explain it to me. You know, you know that what's normative is that people are doing what they want sexually and contracepting and aborting to keep themselves on their career path. That's how the society is structured functionally, as if sex is a sterile act. So we've already absorbed this and taken this in. And then finally, you have to believe men and women are interchangeable in order to believe that genderless marriage is a real thing or a possible thing or a good thing. You have to be able to say that it doesn't matter who your sex partner is, either for marriage, and it certainly doesn't matter whether children have a mother and a father, or two moms, or two dads. None of that matters. Why? How can it be that it doesn't matter? It doesn't matter because men and women are interchangeable. And so as long as you have a pair of hands attached to a person who loves you, it doesn't matter what they do. There is no fatherly presence. There is no mother. There's no maternal thing. There's no paternal thing. It's not true that when dad walks through the door, everyone goes, everybody behaves all of a sudden, or you know, that the dad can do something, the father presence can do something without doing anything. That doesn't exist, that never exists anywhere. And if it exists, it's pathological. You know, that kind of thing. You have to have absorbed all of that to believe that gender doesn't matter to either marriage or parenthood. And we have absorbed that. So these three things that I'm talking about, that men and women are interchangeable, that sex is a sterile activity, that marriage is about adults and not about children, many, many, many people in our society already accept those things. So what does that mean? It means that the gender of the body doesn't matter. This one means gender of the body doesn't matter. The one before means that sex doesn't matter. The one before means that marriage itself doesn't really matter very much. It's just a kind of a convenience, right? So if marriage doesn't matter, sex doesn't matter, the body doesn't matter, what possible difference can it make whether two guys get married? So you've already stripped all the meaning out of it that has anything to do with gender. Okay, so and because so many people in the culture already believe these three things, they can't figure out what's the big deal. They can't figure out why we're holding out, or why we resist, or why we think it's a problem, right? So let me state what the problem is. to believe that gay marriage or something like it, to believe genderless marriage is possible, you have to believe these three things, you have to enshrine these three things into law, and all three of these things are false. All three of these presuppositions are false. And enshrining them into law is not going to do us any good. We've already been doing them, and they haven't been doing us any good. Right? So we're just solidifying, in a sense, the ideology of the sexual revolution. That's part of what genderless marriage is doing, is it's taking the next step of solidifying it. So now, with all of that in the background, I want to zoom in on the mother and the father and the baby, these three people in my little slide here. And I want to do a thought experiment. You can tell they're related because they all have sunglasses. That's a genetically enhanced apparel there. But anyway, just want you to do this little thought experiment. What does society owe to these three people? Now, depending on who you are, where you are, time and history and so on, some people would say, well, we owe them free health care, or we owe them a decent job, or we owe them safe, crime-free streets. You can think of all sorts of things you might say that we owe them. But I think there's something minimal, something more basic than any of those things that we owe these three people. We owe it to them to say that these two people are the parents of the child and no one else is. No one else is. Grandma doesn't have parental rights. Your previous boyfriend doesn't have parental rights. The nanny who maybe spends more time with the child than you do, she doesn't have parental rights. Next door neighbor's got a PhD in social psychology, she doesn't get parental rights, okay? These two people are the parents of the child and no one else is. And that, I would submit to you, is an intrinsically public, that's an intrinsically public function. That's an intrinsically public thing to say we are going to respect and protect the reality that this is the unit. These two people are the parents and nobody else is. No other claimants get to show up and say, I claim a right to have parental rights over this child. Now, the essential public purpose of marriage is to do that. So if you ask yourself, why do we have marriage in the first place? I would say to you, the essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. That's the essential public purpose. It's public in the sense that it's something that requires the activity of the public in order to maintain, and it's different from all the private purposes or the private reasons, the individual personal reasons that people will sometimes give you for why they particularly individually want to get married. So if you think about the kinds of things that we see in the debate over this question, what do we see? We'll hear people saying things like they want to get married because they really love each other and they want to prove that they really love each other. They want to be affirmed. They want to get married because they want to get health insurance benefits. They want to get married because they want the big party. People have, and forget genderless marriage. Just look at regular people. You know, just look at how it's been since time immemorial. People have all kinds of reasons why they want to get married. You want to get your mother and father to stop bugging you about whether you're going to get married. You know, you want to irritate your previous boyfriend. You want the big pretty white dress. You can have all kinds of personal, private reasons why you want to get married, but they don't add up to a public reason to have the institution of marriage in the first place. Because you can get health insurance a lot of different ways. You can have people affirm you a lot of different ways. You can wear a white dress anytime you want. You can have parties anytime you want. You know, those things are not essential, right? The essential public purpose, the reason you have marriage in the first place, is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. Every known society has something like marriage to get that job done. Now, when you see that, when you see that that's the case, if that's the public purpose, it's clear that a same-sex couple is differently situated with respect to that purpose than an opposite-sex couple. Isn't that pretty clear? The way same-sex couples have babies is different from the way an opposite-sex couples have babies. If that was your purpose, you would not demand equality because you would see that something different needs to happen in each case. So therefore, when courts have redefined marriage to remove the gender requirement, they always have to do something about this purpose. They always got to demote this purpose. Now, I'll bet you many of you have had the following conversation with classmates and friends and so on. You'll say something like this, that this is what marriage is about, but there's procreative purpose to marriage, And they'll say something like, but that's not the only purpose. People get married for lots of reasons, but not everybody has children, and so on. And you might even agree and say, well, yeah, I know it's not the only purpose. And they'll say, well, so, see, therefore, these other marriages are just as good, and so on and so forth. But here's what needs to be said next that often people don't see. In order to say that there's no rational basis for treating people differently, you know as well as I do that it's perfectly legal to treat different things differently, right? It's perfectly okay. If something's different, it's okay to treat them differently. That's not unlawful discrimination. So in order to say that there is a requirement for genderless marriage, in order to say that, you have to do more than say this is not the only purpose of marriage. You have to take this off the list altogether. This can't even be on the list. Because if this is a purpose, and an important purpose, and I would say it's the essential purpose, but even if you don't agree with that, that it's a purpose, then it's clear that same-sex and opposite-sex couples are different, and therefore there wouldn't be any legal barrier to treating them differently under law. So when you have that, the courts turn out that the courts know that perfectly well, because when they go to redefine marriage, they always somehow redefine the purpose of marriage. And we had Austin Nimix come to a conference of ours who did a whole, he's an ADF guy, he came and did a whole presentation just on legal things, and he went through case after case and looked at the different things that the courts had said about the purpose of marriage. And they all had something of this kind. Let me read to you Judge Walker's purpose of marriage. He says, marriage is the state recognition and approval of a couple's choice to live with each other, to remain committed to one another, and to form a household based on their own feelings about one another, and to join in an economic partnership and support one another and any dependents. Close quote. That's his idea of the purpose of marriage. And you can see procreation is not even on the list. It's not that it just dropped from position 1 to position 14. It's off the list. And it needs to be off the list for him to make the next move that says there's no reason to have a gender requirement. See? Not only is it not about children, it's also not about sex. Do you see? This doesn't have to be a sexual relationship under the definition that he has here. So you guys who are rooming together during this conference, I would just tell you, don't share too much money with your roommates, because you could count as married by the end of the week under this definition. Okay? So you really are changing the understanding of what marriage is even about. It doesn't have to be a sexual relationship anymore. And once it's no longer a sexual relationship, then the question becomes, why do you need it at all? What is the point of it? So let me explain briefly how marriage accomplishes that essential public purpose. And many of you perhaps already know this, but I want to just go through it to make sure everybody understands it. There's something, a very ancient presumption, that's called the presumption of paternity. And the presumption of the paternity is trying to answer the question, who's your daddy? That's the question. When a baby is born, there's always a mother somewhere close by. Would you agree with that? Yeah, we usually know who the mother is. Now, we have to put a little asterisk up there now, because we have surrogate mothers who are mothers but aren't mothers. They give birth, but... yeah, anyway, forget that for the moment. We know who the mother is. The problem is, who's the daddy? Because daddy can be anywhere. And she doesn't have to tell who daddy is. And he could be dead. He could be on the other side of the moon. Who's your daddy? Marriage answers that question by saying the woman's husband is presumed to be the father of any children that she gives birth to. That's what the presumption of paternity means. The woman's husband is presumed to be the father of any children that she gives birth to during the life of their union. So you can see, if you have that presumption, plus the understanding that people are supposed to be sexually faithful, you're attaching children to their biological parents. And you're doing it in a nice, simple, straightforward way that pretty much works every time, as long as people are only having sex with the person they're married to. So we recognize there are some possible exceptions that are possibly problematic, but as nice bright line rules go, it's pretty good, okay? So what's happening is that the courts are reinterpreting this presumption to accommodate same-sex partnerships, where people will come in and they're redefining, where a couple will come in, two women, for example, will come to court. One of them had a baby, and the other one, and they're now breaking up, and the other one wants to have shared custody with that baby. And so what the courts are doing, under the coaching, you might say, and under the pressure from the whole gay legal establishment, the rule they want to have is a presumption of parentage They want a gender-neutral presumption of parentage, so that if you're in a same, if you're in a union or marriage with anybody of any gender, right, and you have a baby, the other person is presumed to be the child's other parent. And if it's, if the other person is a man and you're married to him, he's most likely the father. If you're married to a woman, in 100% of the cases, she is not the child's other parent. So we're changing the definition of parenthood as a byproduct of changing the definition of marriage. All right? So under the new view of marriage, which says that marriage isn't really gender, marriage can be gender neutral, Judge Walker's view of marriage, marriage doesn't serve any purpose anymore. Gendered marriage served a purpose. There was a social purpose to it. But when you remove the gender requirement, and not only, you're doing more than just removing the gender requirement, you're having to redefine other aspects of law, and by the time you're done with that, you've redefined the purpose, you've redefined the presumptions, the parentage presumption, you're doing a gender-neutral reading of the Uniform Parentage Act, so on and so forth. By the time you've done that, marriage is has no point anymore. Marriage is basically a government registry of friendships. To which one might ask, why do we need a government registry of friendships? And the answer is, we don't. No one needs a government registry of friendships. Let's abolish marriage. And that is, I believe, where the trajectory will go. Okay, and there are people within the movement who, to redefine marriage, who want that outcome. But I think as a, it doesn't matter whether they want that outcome or don't want that outcome. That's the logical step of where it, of where it's going to end up going. Just because you put something in motion that has a life of its own. Now, you may have noticed that I avoid using the term same-sex marriage, and I think a lot of people around ADF do that. And the reason I do that is because I don't think there's any such thing as a same-sex marriage. There's same-sex relationships, same-sex partnerships, but it's not marriage. And so I don't think it's a good idea for me to repeat my opponent's talking points for them. Every time, I don't get that much time at the mic compared to all these other people. You know, they get a lot more time at the mic. So when I get a turn, I'm not going to repeat their ideas for them. So instead of saying, using that term, same-sex marriage, try some of the other terms here that I've put up here. And you've already heard me use some of these as I've been talking here. I want to just point out that some of these are not particularly smooth, easy things that roll right off your tongue. And that's actually a good thing. Okay, so redefining marriage should be the union of any two persons instead of the union of a man and a woman. That takes you a while to say. But the point of it is that it makes you think about what you're really doing. And that's a good thing. When you say same-sex marriage, all you see is two girls in white dresses or two guys in tuxedos, and you're not thinking about the other thing that is actually being put into place. Okay, so it's a good thing to slow that whole mental process down so that people can think about what's going on. Removing the gender requirement for marriage, creating genderless marriage, I like that terminology. A lot of times I'll just say redefining marriage. Okay, and then people will go, well, what do you mean redefining? Now at least people are thinking about what it is that's at stake. Okay, and removing it, when you talk about genderless marriage, then people are going, wait, what is that? What is that? Well, that's what you're doing, is you're removing gender as a basis for marriage, and you're removing gender references from the law. And perhaps some of you are aware of this, what often follows as a direct result of the redefinition of marriage is to go through the statute books and take out mother and father and replace it with parents, parent A, parent B. You know, the birth certificates get changed, marriage licenses get changed, things like that. All of the gender references get taken out. So that's part of the package. That's part of the package of what people are voting for or agreeing to when they describe this as a moral requirement. So what is owed to the child? Go back to that first question that we asked. What is owed? First, I was asking, what is owed to these three people? To recognize the mother and father as the parents of the child. And to legally recognize that and to protect that relationship. And what is owed to the child? I want to always come back to the position of the child. Does society owe anything to children? The premise of the sexual revolution is that we really don't owe children much of anything. Nobody likes to say it quite that bluntly, but that's really kind of what it comes down to. So what I say is that we owe the child an identity. And a knowledge of who they are, a knowledge of their identity. And that is what man-woman marriage does. Man-woman marriage protects your relationship to your mother and to your father proactively. It protects those relationships, recognizes those relationships, and gives you a way of having access to, at least, both of your parents. Okay? So the children's legitimate entitlements are to have a relationship with both of their parents, to know who they are, and therefore, children have a legitimate interest in the stability of their parents' union. Okay, now we shot that in 1968 with no-fault divorce. That's why I brought up no-fault divorce, because it is fundamental. It's a fundamental part of what was done here, right? And it's a fundamental background, you know, in everybody's thinking without people actually naming it. But children have an interest in the stability of their parents' union, and that's what society needs marriage for. Okay, so now what's coming at us if we lose on the definition of marriage, if we lose this case? I want to talk with you about a case that was called In Re MC, which is a little girl called MC. The little girl, and this is a case I want to spend just a few minutes on telling you about this case. Actually, the reason I know about this case is that a few years ago, I had a Blackstone fellow working for me at the Ruth Institute, and I sent him to research all of the lesbian custody cases that he could find. And this is one that he found before it became a big public issue. So part of the reason I know this is because of Austin Muck, and so shout out to Austin Muck from 2011, I think it was. Anyway, this is a case that turned out to lead to a triple parent bill being passed in California. So let me briefly tell you what happened in this case. There's a lady named Melissa and a lady named Irene who married one another in California in October of 2008. So if you remember, October 2008 is in that window where same-sex unions had been found to be legally required by the state of California and before Prop 8. So in that window, Irene and Melissa got married. Melissa was already pregnant when they got married. She was pregnant through a ordinary sexual encounter with a guy named Jesus. And I kind of like that because if you read the case, the only person who behaved honorably was this guy named Jesus, basically. But anyway, so Melissa and Irene got married. Melissa was already pregnant with this little girl who came to be known to the court as MC. The baby was born in March of 2009, and Melissa and Irene and the baby all lived together for about 3 weeks. And then Melissa took the baby and left and decided she didn't want to be part of this relationship anymore, and so she left. Irene decided that she wanted to have parental rights and thought that she was entitled to parental rights, so she went to child services or child welfare or the court or whatever it was. She went to try to get parental rights over the baby, Melissa's baby, and Melissa didn't like that very much, as you might imagine. She didn't like that very much. This is a person she's... let's not judge her motives, but she didn't like it. So she, by this time, Jesus had left the situation. He was off in Oklahoma, I think it was. And so Melissa gets her new boyfriend, a guy called Jose. She and her new boyfriend stalk Irene, and they beat her up and knife her so badly that she has to be hospitalized. And so Jose and Melissa are in jail. Melissa's in jail as accessory to attempted murder. That's where she belongs, is in jail. Irene is in the hospital because she's been very badly injured. And so MC is by herself. Foster care, Child Protective Services come into the situation, take little MC into custody, and put her in foster care. That's what they're going to do. So Jesus gets wind of this somehow, and he reappears and says, I would like to take the child out of foster care. This is my daughter. I'd like to act as parent to my child. And the court looks at him and looks at her, looks at the facts, and kind of scratches their head and say, well, yeah, you are the father. No one disputes that. You seem to be perfectly fit. No one denies that you're perfectly fit. But this little girl already has two parents. Melissa is her mother, because she gave birth to the baby, and Irene is the presumed legal mother because of their legal relationship, because of their marriage. And so children in California can't have three parents, and so therefore, sorry, Jesus, you're out of luck. We're keeping the kid in foster care. So that's how that particular case came out temporarily. There's a lot of back and forth about it. Eventually, Jesus got to be involved with his daughter. But I think most people would look at that and think that this was a reason to not treat a same-sex partnership identically with an opposite-sex partnership, that there's something different going on that needs to be acknowledged in law. And so therefore, you should not have a legal institution that says marriage is the same no matter the gender of the couples. This is a reason to not have genderless marriage. This is a reason to keep gender in the picture as a part of marriage. But that's not what California concluded. California concluded, this is why we need a three-parent bill. We need to amend the law so the children can, at the discretion of the court, have three parents. So now think about that. And when I saw this in the paper, I thought, boy, that's kind of interesting that at the discretion of the court, the child could have a third parent. So I called up the legislator who had introduced this, and I said, do the other parties, the other parents, do they have to give their consent to this third person being named as a parent? And he says, no. No, it's up to the judge. The judge can decide. And I'm thinking to myself, the only reason it would ever happen is because there was something wrong there, and the judge thinks it's the right thing to do. No, their consent is irrelevant. So I'm thinking to myself, and perhaps your wheels are turning here too, that this is another intrusion of the state into the business of the family. So what we have here, the legal institution of genderless marriage, here's what it has done, and this is what the activists want it to do. You have to understand, this is not a fluke. This is the outcome they want. They want it to be presumed that the partner of a mother is automatically considered the child's other parent. So this is a person, the partner, Irene in this case. Irene is not the child's birth mother, and she's not the adoptive mother. Okay, so no adoption had been done. If adoption had been done, I think you would agree the case would be completely different legally. But it would also be morally different because it would be really, really clear that Melissa said, yeah, I want you to adopt my child. I want to be on same equal terms with you. And we explicitly take this step of adoption. No, none of that happened, right? So we have a situation where Irene is not the mother by biology. She is not the mother through adoption. Let us call her a non-parent. So what the gay legal establishment wishes to do is to attach parental rights to non-parents automatically through the institution of marriage. Okay? I think that's a pretty serious step to be taking because it's rewriting the understanding of what parenthood is. Parenthood means the person that your biological parent happens to be in a sexual relationship with, which is quite different from saying that there is a biological relationship between you and both of those people, okay? There was an article not too long ago written by a guy whose parents had been through multiple divorces. This is a guy who said, ultimately, I had six marriages in my childhood because both of his parents had remarried three times. And he was talking about, you know, what that was like, the chaos, the confusion, so on, and the fact that most of those step-parents didn't really care about him very much. Right. Didn't really, you know, and he said, for me, it wasn't that bad because they kind of left me alone. It was not that big a deal. I was kind of sad and stuff, but it wasn't that big a deal. But, he says, think about this. What if every one of those step-parents, marriage partners, what if they had legal parenting rights just by virtue of having married my mother or my father, whatever it was? Think about the leverage that person could use over the biological parent. Think about the additional layer of complexity and chaos that would have been introduced into that situation. So that's what I want you to think about here, is this part of what follows from the redefinition of marriage. You very seldom hear anybody talk about this, right? Very seldom hear anybody talk about this, but we're redefining parenthood as a byproduct of redefining marriage. And I think if you're going to do something that profound, we ought to at least talk about it, rather than just doing it as a byproduct of something else we're trying to get done. Now, the next thing that will come, another thing that will come down the pike, is already coming down the pike, I've alluded to it a little bit, is artificial reproductive technology. This is an unavoidable part of the debate over gay parenting rights, gay marriage, and so on. It's an unavoidable part of it. A lot of us would like to avoid it because people think it's icky or they don't know how to think it through or whatever, or they're already committed to it. They're already committed to a position on it for other reasons. But it's, I think, extremely important that we think through what's going on in the whole realm of artificial reproductive technology. That there is something about this that is intrinsically exploitive. All right, that we're buying and selling human gametes, and that poor women are being exploited for the use of their wombs in a lot of these cases. When you're talking about surrogacy, you need an egg and you need a womb. If you're talking about sperm donation, you just need a sperm and a cup, and you need a turkey baster or whatever. And, I mean, whatever. Anyway, so we're now harming the child's identity rights, the child's right to know who they are, because the intended parents become their legal parents. And the biological relationship is downplayed or diminished or the child separated. The marriage becomes the vehicle that separates the child from one of their biological parents. Rather than marriage being something that attaches children to their parents, it separates them. And so what we want to say about artificial reproductive technology, this was implied in some of the things that I said at the end of my last talk too, is that we're harming children's identity rights and again, changing the relationship between the rich and the privileged and the people who are either young or poor or otherwise vulnerable in these types of relationships. And the final thing that I want to point out about this is the way in which third-party reproduction is affecting the whole marriage market. This is not simply an issue that has to do with same-sex parenting or anything like that. It affects everybody because many people your age are already having their decision-making influenced by the possibilities of third-party reproduction. So in other words, people your age are thinking to themselves, well, I don't really have to get married now because I can always have an IVF baby by myself when I'm 40. Is anybody thinking like that? Is this completely right? I mean, have you? Yeah, you can kind of sense the pressures on you to postpone. And so the idea that IVF is kind of dangling out there, you don't really need a relationship to do it, right? So it's changing your decision-making even now in your 20s because you're not taking the relational part as seriously as you otherwise would if you thought, well, gee, I need to be in a relationship if I'm going to be a mom, you know, if I'm going to become a dad or whatever. You'd think about it differently, okay? And so already, even before you've actually done anything, it's changing how you think and it's changing how you behave. So it's a very important way in which the whole, and remember I said, what does sexual revolution do? It separates sex from procreation. The original idea of separating sex from procreation is, gosh, we're going to be able to have sex without having babies. This is going to be really fun. This is great. We're all looking forward to it. I can tell you, I was there. That's what we all thought. This is going to be great. Well, now we're having babies without having sex. This is another dimension of separating sex from procreation, right? We have babies without sex. I'm pretty sure that's not as much fun as the old-fashioned way, but that's where we are. That's where we are. Okay, so all the different dimensions of sex, marriage, and babies, that whole it's being broken down on all the different possible dimensions. You like my baby there with the barcode on? So remember at the beginning of the talk, I talked about the buying and selling of human beings coming back as part of the sexual revolution. Not too long ago, I think it was last fall, the Washington, D.C. City Council considered a measure that would permit surrogacy contracts to be legal inside the District of Columbia. Now, up until that time, that was a jurisdiction where no surrogacy contracts were legal. And the arguments that people made in front of the D.C. City Council was that we should not only allow gestational surrogacy, but we should also permit what they called traditional surrogacy. Now, since you don't read this stuff every day, let me tell you what those terms mean. Gestational surrogacy is where you get somebody else's egg and you put it in the womb of the surrogate and you've got two separate people involved. Traditional surrogacy, so-called, is a whole lot cheaper. And this is why they were advocating it. You know, a lot of people want to have babies and that gestational surrogacy is really expensive. So as a matter of fairness, equality, equal access, what we need to do is allow traditional surrogacy, which is so much cheaper. It's cheaper because the woman uses her own egg. You don't get another egg, okay? So there's one woman, her egg, she gestates, the man gives her the sperm, she uses the turkey baster, she delivers the baby. When the baby's delivered, he gives her money, she gives him the baby, and that's traditional surrogacy. What has she just done? She sold her baby. Yeah, she sold her baby. And so the upshot of this legislation, of this move by the City Council, is that we're going to be buying and selling babies in the District of Columbia with inside of the Lincoln Memorial. Would you think we had learned anything? That we're going to be buying and selling human beings? Also mentioned that this company called Ova Science is traded on the NASDAQ. Okay, so we're going into the full commercialization of reproduction. The human element is being taken out and replaced systematically by commerce and technology. I want to mention just a couple of things. These are on your slide, so I won't say too much about it. The Anonymous Us Project is something that I commend to you. This is started by a young woman named Alana Stewart Newman. She was herself a donor-conceived person. Her story is very fascinating, very interesting, and she started something called Anonymous Us Project, where people can write in about what their experience was like as a donor-conceived person. What was this like for her? I'll just tell you one little story about Alana. Her mother's first husband was sterile, and so they couldn't have children together. And so they adopted a little girl. And then 5 years later, they wanted to have another child and for some reason couldn't adopt. And so Alana's mother decided that she would do anonymous sperm donation. So Alana's father arrived in a little UPS package, and her mother inseminated herself, and that's how Alana was born. 8 years later, they divorced, which if you think about it is not entirely surprising. If you try to imagine what that married life, I have myself, as a person who went through infertility, I thought about this, you know. Even back then they were talking to people about this kind of thing, and I can't imagine what their married life was like. But in any case, just to go back from the child's point of view, at the age of 8, those parents separated, and the father wanted to have shared custody with the adopted child, but he didn't want shared custody with Alana. So just think about that from the point of view of an 8-year-old child. This is the kind of thing that happens to people. And again, I'll say what I said last time. I don't accept that as normal. And I will never accept that as normal. I don't care how often it happens. So what are we going to do about it? I want to invite you to be thinking about the victims of the sexual revolution and the survivors of the sexual revolution. That's what we're doing at the Ruth Institute, is we're thinking about people who have suffered from earlier rounds of the sexual revolution. So we've already talked about the children of divorce, the reluctantly divorced person, the heartbroken career woman — that's a name I made up for women like me who put her off too long, couldn't have as many children as they wanted, which is now, infertility is now considered kind of a normal part of women's career path, which I think is inhuman. But anyway, our idea is to gather people who have suffered from the sexual revolution, reach out to them, help them to understand their painful experiences, to connect the dots between the pagan ideology of the sexual revolution and what they're going through now, and to see that a lot of people had stuff happen to them. The children of divorce had things happen to them that were not their fault. People like me, that's not true. Nobody did anything to me, but I was lied to. We did accept a bill of goods, and a lot of people are accepting those bill of goods. And we think that if people start to tell their stories and to speak out, that that's going to help change the narrative. And there'll be some counter-narrative to go up against the thing that we're fed all the time. And we also want to give people practical things for improving their situation. Now, this is a book we created called 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage. And I want to just tell you, it seems like it's off topic, but it's really not. Because one of the things that drives the sexual revolution, part of the narrative, is that the 50s were terrible. Right, that was the dark ages. That was the medieval days of the Eisenhower administration. You know, that was terrible. Right? Do you all agree with that? That was a terrible time. You know, women were trapped in loveless marriages, and men had to go to these dreary jobs, and no one had any love, and so on and so forth. You know, so that's part of the story. Leave It to Beaver, we make fun of. Right? We make fun of those TV programs and so on. So that's all part of the story. Well, I was there in the 50s, so I can tell you, it was actually not a bad time to be a kid compared to what kids have to deal with now. But there were problems in the 50s. I mean, after all, we headed for the exits as soon as we could. Sexual revolution dangled these little possibilities in front of us. We're all, oh yeah, right, I'm out of here, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, really, sexual revolution has to do with a lot of separations, right, if you think about it. It has to do with a lot of separations. So what did that family need back there in the 50s? What did Leave It to Beaver really need? What they needed was more love in the family. What they needed was more generosity, more gratitude, more repentance, forgiveness. That's what the family needed. Instead, what the sexual revolution gave us was more exit options and more reasons and methods to separate, more things to complain about, excuses, permission slips to nag our husbands. I'll tell you something, I didn't need any help in that department. I could nag my husband perfectly well without Betty Friedan whispering into my ear that he hadn't picked up his socks or whatever. And my mom was okay in that department too. You know, so all of these resentments that got piled onto us, more reasons for anger and so on, we need to shrug that off and look to the fact that the family needs more love interior to it, and that's where the Christian solution is actually really important. And so I want to talk with you briefly, very briefly, about what you can do. And part of it is that you can become a good listener to your classmates, your friends, and your family. Now, a lot of Christian women my age love this stuff because they know they can do it. They know they can do it. And a lot of you are probably already doing it, right? Because you know people are confiding in you, telling you things, and so on and so forth. And you also know that a lot of times arguing is not helping. Right? You can win the argument and still not make any progress in any way, shape, or form. In fact, you can do a lot of harm with arguments in the wrong place. So I want to give you permission right now to not argue. There are some contexts where you will judge it to be a good thing to not argue. And I trust you with that judgment, right? I mean, you know, if you're in court, you got to argue, okay? You get that. But there are contexts where the person sitting with you needs you to listen to their story. And you will find a place to connect with them. And you will find a way to help them, right? Because when people believe these kinds of things that are so not true, that are so not true, of course they're going to have problems. Right, but they're not going to connect the dots. That's where you're there for. And so I want to give you the confidence to go into these relationships for the long haul with people. Sometimes it takes people a long time to connect those dots or to have so much terrible stuff happen to them that they're ready to listen or they're ready to hear something different. You need confidence to hang in there with them. And I think you can do it. And I believe that this actually is that I'm not telling you to do nothing. I'm telling you to do something very active, very proactive, for you to be a good friend, for you to be a good listener. I think it's huge. Because the fact is, there were a lot of things that the state did to impose the sexual revolution on us. There's no question about it. And I'll tell you all about that in the questions if you want. A lot of imposition by force. But there was also a lot of seduction. Right, a lot of people being seduced out of traditional morality and into ways of life that are destructive. So we got to seduce them back. We got to seduce them back. And all of you can get yourself into positions where you can do that. You're there every day. And that's part of why I want you to have that card, that business card I gave you with the QR on it. I do want to hear from your mom. I'm not kidding, okay? Your mom or your dad or anybody else you know that needs this type of encouragement, that's got a story, that has something to say, right? I want to hear from them, all right? So that's part of it. The final thing I have in this slide is that we need to repent of our own sexual sins. Okay, guys? We need to be real clear about that. Now, I stood up here and I told you that I had an abortion. I, you know, threw it in as part of a joke, right? Do you know how many times I had to confess that before I could stand up here and tell a joke about it? Right, you have to know that it's wrong, and you have to surrender it and let it go and let it go and let it go. Those of you who are Catholics, get your butt into the confessional box once a week, okay? It won't kill you. Actually, it's very good for you, right? And you need to repent. And the world needs us to do that. Otherwise, we're going to look like hypocrites, and we're going to be too freaked out and scared whenever somebody brings up one of these topics. We're going to be like, I can't talk about that because, why can't, why? Why can't you talk about it? Because you've got a lingering guilty conscience, right? And the only way to get over the guilty conscience is to repent. Repent as often as you need to repent. Make amends as often as you need to make amends. You see what I mean? Because that's the only way you're going to be free enough to be a real witness. So I actually think the guilty conscience problem is the core, the psychological core of everything that we're dealing with here. Okay, so what else you can do is join the Ruth Institute, yay. Okay, so you see you have that little QRI thing there? I knew you were all going to have that. So I give you that card. That card's for you to give away. Give it to your mom. I'm not kidding. Okay, so you still have that. All right, now I want to close by telling you about a couple of historical figures, some of whom you've heard of, this one you probably haven't heard of. Bartolomé de las Casas, you can see by his dates that he's like really old. And he's dead, for a long time he's dead. I consider him a tragic hero, okay? He was a Spaniard, he went to the New World, right? And you can see by his dates, he was like right there, right at the beginning, you know, he was there in the New World in South America. And he was a conquistador. He was one of the guys who went over there to exploit the land, exploit the natives. And he saw what was going on, the way the natives were being enslaved. And he said, this is wrong. And he repented of it. And he went back to Spain and he argued with people and he yelled at people and so on. They said, okay, so you're the... They gave him the title. You're the defender of the natives. Okay, so he goes, he's the defender of the natives. Of course, no one would listen to him. No one would listen to him because they're all making money, right? They're making money off the land. They're making money off of slavery and so on. And so he's trying to get somewhere. So he says, well, you know, there's slavery in Africa. Why don't we import Africans? That would work. And people are like, okay, good idea. And he's like, okay, good idea. And they do it. And he's like, after a few years, he's like, bad idea. Why did I do this? What was I thinking? What was I, no! You know, he's like, you know, he's backtracking with all of that, okay? So the reason I'm telling you about this guy is because, first of all, I admire the guy. He's the only guy who said anything. Think about that. He's the only guy who said anything. He's battling all these people. And he thought he could compromise. He thought he could go along to get along. And he lived to regret that. And we got a 500-year-old problem because of that. You see the long-term consequences of going along to get along? It's not his fault. I don't want you to think it's his fault, right? Obviously, a lot of people much more culpable. But his memory would be far more revered if he had never made that little compromise. I think we would all agree with that. Now, look at this photo. Everybody look up and look at this photo. What do we see here? We see a bunch of Catholic prelates in their clerical garb doing the Hitler salute. How does that make you feel, everybody? As a Catholic? It really makes me sick. It upsets me to see that photo. It's revolting. Do we care what their reasons were at this point? Do we care? No, we don't care. There shouldn't be any pictures like this. It shouldn't exist. There shouldn't be anybody like this. How about this picture? Look at this one. There's the Lutherans. Look at the Lutherans. You can tell the little caps. They're little caps and their little collars. Look at that flag. A swastika with this cross in the middle of it. The Lutherans are there. The Lutheran clerics, they're all doing it too. They're all going along to get along. Catholics, does it make you feel better to know that the Lutherans did it too? No. It doesn't do a thing for me. Right? It's terrible. These pictures shouldn't exist. They should have known. Now, how about this guy, Dietrich Bonhoeffer? If Lutherans canonized people, he would be Saint Dietrich Bonhoeffer for sure, right? Right? Because he knew. He understood. He saw Nazism for what it was. And he stood up to it. And we admire him. And we don't give a rip about those other guys. We think they look like idiots. Or worse. How about this guy? Maximilian Kolbe. We actually do canonize our people. Saint Maximilian Kolbe. Polish priest. He saw it for what it was. And he died at Auschwitz. He gave his life for another prisoner. He was in prison because he was a Catholic priest. That's what the Nazis did with Catholic priests. Put him in prison. So he knew and he gave his life for another prisoner. We admire these guys. So the question is, both of these guys, Bonhoeffer and Kolbe, they both saw Nazism for the pagan ideology that it was. And we admire them now. And the fact is, the sexual revolution is also a pagan ideology and no Christian should have anything to do with it. That's a fact. Maybe people didn't get it the first time around. Maybe people didn't get it. But now, we should be able to get it now. We should be able to see it for what it is. Our next speaker, I know, is going to have some very interesting things to say about this. And I just think we should not be compromising with it. We should not be equivocating about it. We shouldn't be making the exceptions to go along to get along. And in that way, we will have no regrets. So, what will our legacy be, this generation? What will our legacy be? That's the question that we have to ask ourselves. Thank you very much.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking to law students from the Blackstone Legal Fellowship about defending marriage in the face of the sexual revolution. Its changing form continues to have wide-scale ramifications for society. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.